Hey everyone, in this video I'm going to show you how to knit the head and tail of a yak, ox, or cow. Yaks and cows are hardy and strong animals that are hardworking, helpful, and adaptable. They're sure-footed and confident, but also slow and stubborn. So if you know someone with similar attributes, this might make the perfect gift. This is a fairly simple pattern with only one color change on the nose and horns. The tuft of the hair at the top of the head and on the tail is made with fringe stitch. You'll need about 3 ounces or 50 grams of DK or sport weight yarn, or about 3 to 4 times that if you're using worsted weight. Yaks, oxen, and cows come in a variety of colors, but my favorite combination so far is a darker body and legs with a lighter color nose. You'll also need about a yard of darker contrast yarn for the eyes and nostrils. I like using a black yarn with a little bit of sparkle. Remember to use knitting needles that are at least 2 sizes smaller than what's recommended for the yarn you're using. That helps you make tighter stitches so that the stuffing doesn't show through. Some other things you'll need are stuffing, a crochet hook for the fringe stitches, scissors, and a tapestry needle for sewing the seams. It's also a good idea to have some type of row counter so that you can keep track of which row you're on. The techniques and stitches you'll need for this animal are stockinette, basic increases and decreases, mattress stitch for the seams, and fringe stitch for the tufts on the head and tail. Since this is a pattern video, I'm assuming that you already know how to do the basic stitches like knit, purl, knit 2 together, and purl 2 together. So I'll tell you where to do these stitches, but I won't take the time to explain how to do them here. Before we get to the pattern, just a few things. I knit in combination style, so it may look a little strange. I use it because it's faster and easier, especially for purling. You don't have to knit in combination style, but if you'd like to learn how to do combination knitting, look in the description area of this video for a link to a video that explains how. Please like this video and share it with your knitter friends, then subscribe to my channel so it can grow and more people can find my videos. After you click subscribe, if you click that little bell, you'll get notifications whenever I release new videos. Click Show More in the description area to find lots of links to additional videos, such as additional animal and clothing patterns, special techniques and stitches that I use in my patterns, and my favorite place to get yarn. When you finish your project, please share photos. I've created a Painted Cricut Facebook page just for that. You can find a link for that also in the description area. And one last thing, if you prefer to work from a written pattern, you can also find links to the shops where I sell them in the description area. This video focuses only on the head and tail. All of my animals use the same body and leg patterns, so there are separate videos to show you how to knit them. You can find links to all of those videos in the description area too. I think this animal looks best with just the basic body all in one color and simple round feet in a contrasting color, but that's completely up to you. If you like the longer feet or plan to knit shoes, just be sure to choose the leg pattern for the legs with the long feet. Otherwise, the shoes won't fit very well. The only special stitch in this pattern is the fringe stitch for the tuft of hair at the top of the head, and I'll show you how to do that in this video. Okay, let's get started with the head. To start the head, cast on 12 stitches in the color you're using for the nose. Almost all of my patterns started the nose and worked to the back of the head. Be sure to leave enough of a yarn tail that you'll have something to sew with once you're done. On row 1, just purl across without any increases or decreases. Remember that I use combination style knitting, so if my purling and knitting looks strange, that's probably why. Row 2 is an increase row. Knit the first stitch, then increase 1. Then knit 2 and increase 1 5 times until you get to the last stitch, and then just knit that one. You should have 18 stitches when you get to the end of row 2. By the way, my favorite way of increasing is often called make 1. It's one of the most invisible increases, and you make it by working into the stitch on the previous row, just below the stitch on your right needle. Pull one leg of that V up onto the left needle and then knit into that stitch, and that's called a make 1. On row 3 and all of the wrong side rows until we get to row 25, you'll just simply purl across. Row 4 is another increase row, so knit 1, increase 1, and then do a pattern of knitting 3 and increasing 1. Do that pattern 5 times. Just simply knit the last 2 stitches, and now you should have 24 stitches. Rows 5 through 7 are basic stockinette, so just knit across on the right sides and purl on the wrong sides without any increases or decreases. Row 8 is where you change from the nose color to the main color. You can cut your nose color yarn here, leaving just enough to tie off. And since you won't see the wrong side, you can tie a simple knot to secure these ends, and nobody will ever see them. After changing color, just knit across this row. Continue doing stockinette in the main color until you get to row 10. Rows 10, 14, 16, and 18 are all increase rows. These increases build up to the widest part of the head. On row 10, knit the first 2 and then begin the K3M1 pattern until you have 4 stitches remaining. Knit those last 4 stitches without increases, and that should give you 30 stitches. On row 14, knit the first 2 and then begin the K4M1 pattern until you have 4 stitches remaining. Knit those last 4 stitches without any increases. And now you should have 36 stitches. On row 16, knit 5 and increase 1 until you get to the last 6, and then just knit those without increasing. That gives you 42 stitches. On row 18, knit 6 and increase 1 until you get to the last 6, and then knit those, giving you 48 stitches. Now you're done increasing, and we just need to do knit on the right sides and purl on the wrong sides until we get to row 25, and that's where we'll begin decreasing to get the rounded back of the head. So when you get to row 25, purl the first 3 and then decrease by doing a P2 together. Then begin a pattern of purling 6 and decreasing 1. You'll do that 5 times and then purl the last 3. You should have 42 stitches at the end of this row. On row 27, purl 2, P2 together, and then begin the pattern of purling 5 and decreasing 1 until the last 3 stitches, which you'll just purl. That should give you 36 stitches. On row 29, purl 2, and then begin the pattern of decreasing 1 and purling 1 to the last stitch, and then just purl that one. And now you should have 25 stitches. On row 31, purl 1 and then P2 together 11 times. and purl the last two stitches individually. Since we decreased 11 times, you should have 14 stitches now. Row 33 is the final row. Purl 1 and then pea 2 together 6 times. And purl the last stitch, leaving you with 8 stitches on your needle. We won't cast off here. Instead, cut your yarn and leave enough that you can sew the seam and then attach the head to the body later. Thread this tail onto a tapestry needle and then carefully thread the tail back through each stitch on the needle. Just to be safe, I like to thread the tail through those same stitches one more time and then pull tight so I get a nice round edge for the back of the head. And now sew the bottom head seam a little less than halfway from the back to the bottom of the head. Then you'll take the tail that you left at your cast on edge and weave this through each stitch of the cast on edge to create a little round end for the nose. Then sew this end of the head seam a little less than halfway from the nose to the bottom of the head. You want to leave a wide enough opening at the bottom where you can add stuffing into the head later. That finishes up the knitting for the main headpiece, which gives us the head and nose. So now we're ready to knit the ears and horns. Let's start with the ears. So start by casting on 7 in the main color. Don't forget to leave an end for sewing with later. I like to knit both ears at the same time. It helps me knit them both in a consistent way. I do the same with the arms, legs, and horns. Just find the other end of the yarn and cast on 7 for the second ear with that end. Purl across on row 1 and every odd row until row 11. We'll increase on rows 2, 4, 6, and 8. On row 2, the pattern is knit 2 and increase 1. Do that 3 times and then knit the last stitch. You should have 10 stitches. You don't need to do anything special on rows 3, 5, 7, and 9, just purl across on these rows. On row 4, knit 2 and increase 1 again. Do that 4 times and then knit the last 2 stitches. You should have 14 stitches when you're done. On row 6, knit 2 and increase once, and do that pattern 6 times. Then knit the last 2 stitches, and you should have 20. On row 8, start by knitting 1 and then begin a pattern of knitting 3 and increasing once. Do that 5 times and then knit the last 4 stitches, giving you 25 stitches. Do simple stockinette for rows 9 and 10. On rows 11, 13, and 15, we'll do some decreases. So for row 11, the pattern is P1 and then P2 together. Do that 8 times and then purl the last stitch. On row 13, purl the first stitch and then P2 together 7 times. Then purl the last 2 stitches individually. You should have 10 stitches when you're done. On row 15, purl the first stitch and then purl 2 together 4 times. Then purl the last stitch. This is the last row and you should have 6 stitches left for each ear. Cut the yarn, leaving enough to sew with. Thread this tail onto a tapestry needle and then carefully thread the tail back through each stitch on the needle. Again, I like to thread the tail back through those same stitches one more time and then pull tight. And this gives a nice tip for the ear. Now fold the ear in half, and then sew the side seam back down to the cast-on edge. I like to fold the ear so that there's a little indentation on the front side. When we're ready to assemble all the head pieces, we'll sew the ears onto the sides of the head, just in front of the horns. Now we're ready for the horns. Horns are typically a lighter color, so I'm going to use this cream color. This particular yarn is a lighter weight yarn than the yarn that I used for the main color, so I'm going to double it. Doubling the yarn makes it closer, so I'm going to knit with two strands held together here. And as with the ears, I'm going to knit both horns at the same time. Start by casting on 8 in a cream or white color. This cast on row is the base of the horns, where they're sewn onto the head. Now do 9 rows of stockinette, starting with the purl row. On row 10, we'll do our first decrease row. Knit 1 and then decrease in whatever way you like to decrease. I'm going to do a knit 2 together in combination style, so it's through the back of the loops for me. But just be sure to do all of your decreases for the rest of the horn in the same way. At the end of row 10, you should have 6 stitches. Rows 11 through 13 continue in stockinette with no decreases. On row 14, knit the first 2 stitches, then knit 2 together, and then knit the last 2 stitches. This should give you 5 stitches. Rows 15 through 17 continue in stockinette. On row 18, knit 1, knit 2 together, and then knit the last 2 stitches. Just purl on row 19. On row 20, knit the first stitch, then knit 2 together, and then knit the last stitch. Purl across on row 21. And then we form the tip of the horn on row 22. Slip the first stitch, knit the next 2 together, and then pass the slip stitch over that stitch that's left. Cut the yarn, leaving enough to sew with. Thread this tail onto a tapestry needle, and then thread that through the final stitch on the needle. Now fold the horn in half, and then sew the side seam back down to the cast on edge. If you put a little extra tension on the yarn as you sew the side seam, it will help the horn to curve slightly. I also like to bend the tip up as I sew the horn, and as you work with it, it starts to hold that curve. Now you have all the pieces you need to begin assembling the head. You have the main headpiece, the ears, and the horns. So now grab some scissors, a tapestry needle, and a crochet hook. You'll also need some stuffing, some yarn scraps for the tuft of hair that we'll add at the top, and some darker yarn for the eyes and nostrils. I like using yarn with a little bit of sparkle for the eyes and the nostrils. Stuff the stuffing through the little hole that you left at the bottom of the head. I'm always surprised at how much stuffing it takes, but be careful not to add so much that it makes the stitches spread apart. Finding the positions for the ears and horns is a little tricky. I like to start by holding them into position with my hands, just to get an idea of where they look best. Then I use the extra yarn that I left when I cast it on and cast it off, and sew just a stitch or two as a temporary stitch that I can remove easily if the position isn't quite right. I also like to sew across the bottom edge of the ear and pull that tight so the ear has a stronger indentation. Then I move back and forth between the two ears, sewing a little more on both sides. Since we also have horns, I'll follow the same process with the horns, sewing a couple temporary stitches to begin with, and then seeing how the ears and horns look both with each other and with the ears and horns on the opposite side. This process takes quite a while, but I found that it saves time in the end because I have fewer stitches to unpick. It also helps to have a photo to look at as you're going. I include photos in my written patterns, and there's a link to the shops where I sell those in the description area of this video. I like to stand back and look at how everything's fitting together quite a bit, especially as I'm assembling the head. Then I can add a stitch to pull the ear or horn a little to the left or the right as needed. After the ears and horns are sewn on, it's easier to find the positions for the eyes and nose. Thread the darker thread onto your needle and then bring that up through the hole and into the position for the first nostril. They lean to the outside and sit about 2 to 3 inches apart at the top. Add one stitch on both sides. Then take that same yarn and come out through the position for the first eye. Be careful not to position the eyes too high on the forehead. I find that they generally look better closer to the nose. Use the position of the horns, ears, and nostrils to line up where you want your eyes. It's most important that they're positioned consistently on both sides. I use a French knot to make the eyes. Pull the yarn out at the position where you want the eye to be. Then stick your needle back in through that same place and come back out one stitch away. Be careful pulling the yarn here. You want to leave a little loop that you can stick your needle into to begin the knot. Pull the loop snug against the needle, and then while holding it in place, wrap the yarn 5 to 6 times around the needle. Then hold the loop and wraps carefully with one hand as you pull the needle and yarn through them, creating a little circle of loops. To secure the little circle of loops into position, I like to add a couple more loops by stitching close near the bottom of the eye onto the head and then coming back out through the center of the loops. I like to do this a few times until the eye feels secure. Now follow these same steps to add the second eye into position, always remembering to step back now and again to make sure the position of the eyes looks good with everything else. And now we're ready for the tuft of fur at the top of the head. You'll need a bunch of scraps of yarn, about 3 inches long. You can use the same colors you've been using, or even try using contrasting colors. For this tuft, I like to add 5 to 6 fringe stitches, which are made by holding 3 to 4 pieces of yarn together. Stick the crochet hook under the stitch where you want the first fringe stitch to go. Fold the yarn scraps in half, grab the center fold with the hook, and then pull the yarn through the other side, just enough to create a small loop on the other side. Then grab both ends of the yarn scraps and pull them through that little loop that you created. Tug slightly at both ends until the knot is snug against the head. Repeat these steps until you like the size of the tuft of fur. When all the fringe stitches are added, then it's time to give them a little haircut. Comb through the fringe stitches with your fingers so they're lying straight. Then take your scissors and trim the yarn into kind of a triangle type shape with a point at the top. Then fluff the stitches out so they look more natural. The yarn clippings make great stuffing. I like to add them into the bottom of the head. That's the final head detail, so now we can sew the rest of the bottom head seam. Locate the original yarn that was used to sew the head seams, and then stuff all the other straggling ends inside the head. Then finish sewing the seam, leaving just an end of yarn for sewing the head to the body later. And now we're ready for the tail. For the tail, I like to use a knitted or cable cast on because it leaves you with fewer ends to weave in, but you can really use whatever cast on method you like best. Start by casting on 18 in the main color. Then, bind off as you knit across these same stitches. At the tip of the tail, that's the end without all of the loose ends, if you use the knitted or cable cast on. At the tip of the tail, add 3 to 5 fringe stitches, using the same yarn scraps you used for the tuft of hair at the top of the head. Trim the fringe stitches here into a sort of triangle shape, as we did for the tuft of hair on the top of the head. After you've knitted the body and legs, you'll sew the tail into position on the back of the body, using the legs and back of the head to help you find the center position. I like to add the tail near the widest part of the body. And that's it for this video. Now you've got the head and tail, which are the most difficult and detailed pieces. All that's left now is the body and the legs. All of my animals use the same body and leg patterns, so I show how to do them in a separate video. Look in the description area for a link to that video. I don't usually knit clothes or shoes for the yak, but if you want your yak to have shoes, just remember that for the bottom legs, you want to follow the pattern for the legs with the long feet. There's also a video that shows my favorite tips and tricks for assembling all the pieces together. Look for that in the description area as well. Here's a quick overview of how it all goes together. Thanks for watching this video. Don't forget to like it and subscribe to my channel so you can get notified when I release new animal and clothing patterns. And share a photo of your completed project on my Facebook page. See you next time!